So welcome back to another installment of Secret Graceland, where we'll explore new corners of our favorite house. Before we get started, go ahead and click subscribe if you haven't already. All right, let's jump in. So right in the front of the house, I want to stop and talk about a rumor and dispel it because it is not true. Here is a photo of Elvis and actress Yvonne Lyme in front of Graceland soon after it was purchased on Easter weekend, 1957. It's come to my attention that people believe that the large window in the dining room used to be a door. I believe it's this photo that has led to this. Maybe someone claimed it was a door in their video, but it is 100% not. This photo is kind of an illusion. The glass is reflecting the white part of the house to make it look like a door is open. But I want to point out how high it is off the ground, first of all. Second, if you watched my Secret Graceland video about the egress windows in the basement, we talked about how there is a gap in between the window and the window well to allow ventilation in the basement. Above ground, it looks like a grate, and we can see the top of it in this photo. Here is another clear photo from that same time, and if we look closely at the dining room window, it has a clearer reflection of the shutter on the window next to it. So this is a large window and not a door. Walking into the house, let's stop at the foyer. In a past Secret Graceland video, it was actually a live video for Elvis's birthday, we talked about how on January 8, 1958, Elvis's 23rd birthday, he had a young visitor over named Mary Kozlowski. Mary was just 8 years old and a polio survivor. The two took a bunch of really cute photos in this area of the house that gives us a great peek at Graceland in the early days. I'll link that video below if you'd like to watch it. In it, I also mentioned that Elvis unfortunately kept his young guest waiting for about 2 hours until he came down to greet her, and I'd like to expand on this. According to Anita Wood's book, Elvis and Anita, by Janita Brewer Barrett, he left little Mary waiting for 2 hours because he was sleeping off the birthday party he had the previous night, which, fun fact, included Gary Pepper. Anita Wood also explains that while Mary and her family visited with Elvis and photographers snapped their pictures, she was actually upstairs the entire time. Now let's explore inside the living room. Here is a black and white but very clear photo of Elvis and his parents in front of the original 15-foot couch. I say original because, of course, the first upholstery was blue, not white. Here they are talking to the press about Elvis's army induction the day before he leaves. So this is March 23rd, 1958. What we can see here is the coffee table right in front of them. There's a glass top, but let's take a look at the edge. There's a detailed pattern that runs all along the side. Here's a photo from March 1965. Elvis is relaxing on the couch, which by this point has been reupholstered to the second version with buttons and texture, but it's not the one that we see today. Elvis has his foot up on the coffee table. It's got the glass top, but we can't see the edge of the table like we could in the 1958 photo. Lastly, here's a view from today. Smoky glass top coffee table, but the edge is now smooth. In the music room, there are multiple doors and windows with so much natural light. Here is a black and white photo of most of the curtains in the room pulled back, and we can see how much light floods this room from the front of the house and the back. However, in the 1970s, after the 1974 remodel especially, there was this huge hutch blocking the front windows. This cabinet is rather large, with so much storage and shelving right in front of a red curtain that's also covering the windows. It's just an interesting design choice. The next room on our tour is the dining room. When the Presleys bought the house in 1957, they did a lot of renovating to transform it into their tastes. Well, to be real, Elvis's tastes. A lot of that included removing the antique fixtures that were left in the house from the previous owners. The Moores that owned Graceland first enjoyed antiques and curated their home to reflect this. According to Ruth Cobb, who grew up at Graceland, the chandelier that her parents had in the dining room was actually from New Orleans. Here's Ruth at the center of this photo. We can see the beautiful chandelier that her parents added to this space. But if we look at a view of the dining room in 1963, the chandelier has been replaced. Maybe it wasn't Elvis's style, or it just seemed old-fashioned. He chose a very funky chandelier with gold pieces sticking out of it. So here's a fun story about the kitchen. I created a story about Gary Pepper, Elvis's number one fan, and also his friend for the duration of his career. Gary is one of my favorite stories ever, so if you're interested in checking it out, the link is in the description box. So Gary had cerebral palsy and was confined to a wheelchair, but that didn't stop him from accomplishing some great things in the Elvis community. I've read about different people that Elvis wanted to help financially, such as Dewey Phillips, but didn't want them to feel like they were receiving charity. So in Gary's case, Elvis paid him $135 weekly for his role of fan club coordinator and foreign correspondent. This salary would actually equal about $2,500 a month today. Gary's nurse Nancy, who I did an interview with, I'll link that video below as well, told me a cool fun fact about this. She said they would go pick up Gary's paychecks at Graceland, where it was always left in a dish on the cabinet counter. This is the built-in cabinet on the wall where the staircase is. There's a bread warmer drawer right underneath. I'm not sure if all the guys picked up their paychecks in this spot, but that's where Gary's checks were left. Let's talk about something else in this general area. If we were on a tour of the house, right in front of us would be the jungle room. That is where Elvis recorded the album Moody Blue in 1976 with the whole band set up in there. But when Elvis delivered his vocals, he was standing on the step that leads down into the room. It's roped off for us, but we can clearly see it and admire this area when we're walking through. Today, this step that Elvis used as his stage is covered by the same carpet that runs all the way through from the kitchen, but back in 1976, it was covered with the green shag from the jungle room. Check out this photo from the perspective from the kitchen. Gary was picking up his checks from the cabinet on the right where the woman is leaning. It's dark beyond the kitchen and kind of difficult to see, but the original patchwork kitchen carpet ends right at the threshold, and just beyond it, the green shag begins. Now, let's walk downstairs to the basement to check out the TCB den before it was the TCB den. In this photo from March 1960, Elvis is standing where we stand at the ropes to look out into the room. The pool room is directly behind him. Really, the only thing that stayed the same in here is the fake abstract painting that covers the projector in the wall next to the bar. The lights above the bar, which are recessed in the ceiling today, stuck out in long cone lamps back then. Also, the bar had a totally different look. In the 70s, it was changed to padded yellow around the bottom as well as the edges where you put your arms if you were sitting there. In the early days, there was a diamond-shaped pattern in a dark color covering the bottom of the bar. The trophy building in Elvis's time was very different than the way that we see it today. Initially, it held his slot car track. Then in 1967, Elvis and Priscilla had their second wedding reception in there. In the 1970s, it was a different space. This is where he kept his trophies, gold records, awards, anything like that was kept here and on display. We can see from pictures from around 1975 that it started to resemble the exhibit space that we know today. All the gold records hung in cases behind glass. There were display cases in the middle of the room for all of his achievements, as well as art and fan gifts. That all went into the trophy building. Something interesting that I wanted to point out was this bar area in the back next to the exit door that we used to go towards the pool. Of course, there was no alcohol served here. This bar had sodas for guests. We can see the Pepsi logo, Elvis's favorite. So in the last Secret Graceland video, I brought up this photo of the back of the Meditation Garden wall, which was sent in by Eric Vanderberg on Facebook. There are these intricate wheel shapes and swirl patterns all along the side of the wall. They don't actually go all the way around the back of the wall. Here is a full view and the pattern does not continue. But after reading more about it, here are what the wheel patterns are. Wheels of life in Buddhism. There's deeper meaning to each level, but essentially, these represent the cycles of life. Remember, at the time of the wall's construction in 1965, Elvis was enthusiastic about learning about different cultures and beliefs than just the ones that he'd been raised with. I think it's a really beautiful meaning. It's interesting that this was intentionally placed, yet it's an area that anyone hardly gets to see. And also, that this space eventually became Elvis's final resting place. It really makes you think. And that is it. What was your favorite part? Let me know in the comments below. Also, follow me on Facebook and Instagram for rare photos and fun facts that don't make it into the videos. I'll also be sharing some of the photos I used in this video. The links for both of those are in the description box below. And as always, thank you so much for watching, and please subscribe for more adventures.